Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Anupama, professor at Department of Economics, Punjabi University, Patiala. I am going to talk about the module Urbanization, Health and Gender from Population, Urbanization and Poverty. So students, we are going to discuss about the gender discrimination in attainment of health and nutritional status in many cities of the developing countries. This module aims to throw light on urbanization, health and gender, the nutritional status of women, anemia among females, missing girl child in urban areas, mortality among the infants and children under age 5, and the leading causes of death among the females. Urbanization is always associated with higher income levels, increased opportunities, and better facilities as compared to rural setups, which means that the quality of life in urban areas is better than that of the rural areas. Among all the basic amenities of urban life, health is considered to be a very important aspect. The urban residents have more and better medical facilities as compared to their rural counterparts. But as we know, every picture has two sides. The unmanageable growth of the cities also leads to an eruption of a number of problems. Increasing congestion, pollution, and growth of slums are also the features of a urban life. Such conditions lead to health problems. However, these problems have different effect on different social groups, among which the women are always placed in a relatively disadvantageous position. While cities open many possibilities for women to meet, work, and form social support networks, women living in cities also face unique challenges. These include heightened risk of physical, sexual, and psychological violence, barriers in accessing health and social services due to lack of control over family financial resources, childcare responsibilities, restricted mobility, and limited decision-making power, and lack of education and economic security relative to men. Urban poverty has become highly feminized. Compared to their male counterparts, poor urban women tend to have lower paying jobs and higher illiteracy rates. They also are excluded from certain types of jobs because of lack of education or discriminatory practices. On top of this, women are often excluded from land and home ownership and inheritance. All these factors place poor urban women and their dependents at increased risk for a range of health problems. Lack of attention to these determinants has led to a systematic devaluation and neglect of women's health in urban areas. Within households, girls and boys, women and men often do not receive equal access to nutritious food and health care. Norms and values that lead to societal acceptance of violence against women or control over women's reproduction and sexuality contribute to a range of reproductive and sexual health conditions for women. In this respect, we will have an overview of gender discrimination in health in general, and then in urban areas in particular. Health and gender. Biologically, women are expected to live longer than men, and this has been proved historically as well. Many reasons are cited for it. In general, It is believed that women are less involved in activities, habits, etc., which are detrimental to health, and along with the biological differences, women tend to have a higher life expectancy than men. This is shown in figure 1. The figure shows that the life expectancy of women are higher than the men, although this gap is narrowing down. At the global level, both male and female life expectancy has increased. Recent increases have been largest in low-income countries, where both the male and female life expectancy increased by about 9 years between 1990 and 2012. See figure 2 for these trends. We can see that this is more than twice as compared to high-income countries. It is only in low-income and lower-middle-income countries that the increase in life expectancy of women is higher than that of men, while in upper-middle-income and high-income countries, the gain in life expectancy is higher for males than females. This is due to the reason that the females have already achieved a very high level of life expectancy. Like adult women, the girls are also less likely to die under the age of 5 than boys are. This can be found in majority of the countries, but in a few overpopulated economies such as India and China, the mortality rates for girls are higher than that of the boys. This leads to a higher mortality rate for girls than boys in the Asian region. The changes in child mortality for both the boys and girls have been shown in figure 3. The figure shows that the global progress on reducing child mortality has been significant since 1990. According to the latest estimates, the under 5 mortality rates has declined from 90 to 48 deaths per 1,000 live births. There has been progress in all regions, but this progress has been uneven. In 2012, Sub-Saharan Africa and Southern Asia together accounted for 82% of the total number of under 5 deaths globally, up from 67% in 1990. Due to their physiological advantage over boys in terms of child survival, in the majority of countries where data are available, girls enjoy a better survival over boys. However, there are important exceptions. Southern Asia, for example, has a slightly higher under 5 mortality rate for girls than for boys, implying the existence of discriminatory practices related to son preference. Maternal mortality. Though women tend to live longer, yet the periods of pregnancy cause a major threat to life and also to physical capabilities in rest of their lives. The Millennium Development Goals have aimed to reduce the maternal mortality ratio from its 1990 level by 3/4 and achieving universal access to reproductive health services by the year 2015. The number of women dying due to complications during pregnancy and childbirth decreased by nearly 50% from an estimated 5,23,000 in 1990 to 2,89,000 in 2013. Yet, much more needs to be done. While such progress is notable, the average annual rate of decline is far below that needed to achieve the MDG target, and the number of deaths remains unacceptably high. In 2013, nearly 800 women died every day from maternal causes. Almost all of these deaths, that is 99%, occur in developing countries, and most can be avoided as the necessary medical interventions exist and are well known. The key obstacle is the lack of access to quality care by pregnant women before, during, and after childbirth. These differences in the maternal mortality rates per 1 lakh of live births, according to the average level of income of the countries, can be observed from figure 4. The figure shows that the low-income countries have been able to reduce the maternal mortality rates only by half and are still at a very high level of maternal mortality rate of 450 per lakh of live births as compared to 240 in lower middle income countries and merely 17 in high income countries. Reaching the level of high income countries yet appears to be a distant dream for the low income as well as low middle income countries. Actually, among all the low income countries, major contribution in the maternal mortality rates has been made by the sub-Saharan Africa and Southern Asia, which together accounted for 85% of the total maternal deaths. Further, going by the causes of maternal death, it is being felt that 80% of these deaths could be avoided if women had access to essential maternity and basic healthcare services. The causes of maternal mortality in different regions are shown in figure 5. The figure shows that the causes of maternal mortality vary by region but are generally due to a lack of emergency obstetric care services, low levels of skilled assistance at delivery, particularly for poor women, and the continued denial of sexual and reproductive health and rights for women and girls in many countries. In particular, unsafe abortions also constitute a leading cause of maternal deaths. Globally, in 2008, an estimated 21.6 million unsafe abortions took place, mostly in developing countries, resulting in 47,000 deaths. In Latin America, abortions alone are responsible for 12% of all maternal deaths. Similarly, childbearing at a younger age, most often stemming from early marriage, constitutes a significant health risk for women and their children. With this overview about the average health attainments among men and women, we can see how urban areas contribute to these differences. A rational human being also strives for a better life, and urbanization is often a manifestation of such tendencies of the populations across the world. People move to urban areas for finding better income opportunities, better facilities, or in short, better lives. While urbanization comes with new opportunities and many options, it is also associated with scarcity of resources, lack of infrastructure, and deprivations in social structure. In urban areas, people face new health risks caused by poor sanitation, pollution, stress, crime, and congestion. In congested cities, people face an increased risk of communicable diseases and infections. Women are more compromised than men under these urban conditions due to gender inequities and to a lack of awareness among urban developers and policymakers of their specific needs and concerns. Urbanization creates new issues for health and healthcare for women, and although there has been attention to the relationship between urbanization and health, less is known about the interaction of these three subjects: urbanization, gender, and health. A focus on the role of gender in urban health is absent from dialogues about urbanization. Further, limited dialogue exists on the intersection between public spaces and women's healthcare needs. Due to all these reasons, we have limited information about the gender differences in health outcomes in urban areas. The main global data repositories on health issues either give the data on health outcomes in urban areas without adding the gender dimension to it, or provide gender differences in health outcomes without the rural-urban breakups. The gaps in information are very crucial, particularly when the urban environments with their specific social and structural characteristics have an undeniable impact on the health and well-being of urban populations, especially on women, who are more at risk because of the prevailing gender divide and limited access to resources and health services. Therefore, due to limited information on gender-based urban data across countries, we would focus here on Indian scenario, which is a good reflection of the conditions in developing economies. First of all, let us look at the nutritional status of men and women in selected cities in India. This is given in Table 1. Table 1 measures the nutritional status of men and women in urban areas of India. Here, the nutritional status has been measured as a body mass index, which is a measure of body fat based on height and weight that applies to adult men and women. It is the ratio of weight to height square. On basis of the body mass index, a person is very thin or underweight if the index value is less than 18.5. And out of the group of people being categorized as underweight, a person would be moderate or severely thin if the index value is even lower than 17. Further, a person would be having normal weight if the index value is between 18.5 and 25. Overweight if index value is between 25 and 30, and obese if the index value is more than 30. From Table 1, we can see that in most of the Indian cities, the proportion of total thin men is greater than that of the women, except in Indore. However, if we go by the wealth quintile, we can see that in Mumbai and Indore, in the poorest quintile, more of the women are thin than men, and the difference is the largest in case of Indore. What is more worrisome is that if we separate the category of moderate and severely underweight persons from the category of total thin persons, a greater proportion of women than men lie in this category in all the cities except Nagpur and Chennai. Further, the proportion of women is also higher than men in the category of overweight and obese, which further creates a number of health problems. More of the women being severely underweight and also overweight and obese lead to greater incidence of diabetes and anemia. These facts can be observed from Figure 6 and Figure 7. Figure 6 shows the percentage of anemic men and women in selected cities of India. Figure 6 shows that proportion of women having anemia is much higher than men in selected cities of India. We can see that among all the cities shown here, the prevalence of anemia is the highest for both men and women in Kolkata. However, the gender gap in prevalence of anemia is found to be the widest in the cities of Hyderabad and Chennai. Figure 7 shows per 1,000 men and women suffering from diabetes in selected cities of India. We can see that per 1,000 occurrence of diabetes among women इज हायर देन मेन इन दिल्ली, कोलकाता, इंदौर एंड चेन्नई, बट इट इज लोअर इन मुंबई, नागपुर एंड हैदराबाद. द जेंडर गैप इन इंसिडेंस ऑफ दिस हेल्थ प्रॉब्लम इज द हाइएस्ट इन चेन्नई. ड्यू टू कंजेशन, पोल्यूशन एंड अनसेनेटरी कंडीशंस, अर्बन सिटीजन्स आर मोर वल्नरेबल टू ट्यूबरक्लोसिस. अदर प्रेवलेंट डिजीजेज आर एस्थमा, गॉयटर एंड अदर थायराइड डिजीजेज, बट these diseases have unequal effect on men and women. These can be observed from figure 8. Figure 8 shows that in urban India, as compared to men, more of women are suffering from diabetes, goiter and other thyroid disorders. This is true in all of the selected cities. In case of thyroid, while in case of diabetes, we have the exceptions of Mumbai, Nagpur and Hyderabad. Similarly, in case of asthma and tuberculosis, the incidence among women is lower in 3 or 4 cities out of the selected cities. Actually, the data for the tuberculosis may be underestimating the problem both for men and women, and perhaps more for women, as it shows the cases who have been treated with the same disease. In the poorest quintile, where this disease has greater incidence, many of the suffering people may not be using any health facility to get this disease diagnosed and then treated. This is more valid in case of women. Another important issue is that of missing girl child in urban areas. In the discussion so far, we have observed how females are more often marginalized and so have poor health outcomes than the males in urban areas. This discrimination is found throughout the life course of women. But what we have not discussed so far is the issue whether the women are allowed to live or even to take birth. The socio-economic cultural thinking in India and many developing countries, which have exhibited gender discrimination in every area of life, also promote preference for male child. Breaking law and indulging in illegal activities is also an acceptable practice for fulfilling that desire for male child amongst the Indian families. While arguing the socio-cultural causes behind this phenomena, we may think that this should not be happening in the modern and more educated urban setup. But the irony is that this is happening more in the urban areas than the rural ones. Looking at the case of India, we can easily see the gradual missing of girls in urban as well as rural areas. Table 2 shows that the sex ratio in India has improved from 933 in 2001 to 940 in 2011, and more of this improvement can be attributed to the urban areas. But still, the sex ratio in urban areas is far below that of the rural areas. On the other hand, we can see that the sex ratio in the age group 0 to 6 years has rather declined in the country from 927 in 2001 to 914 in 2011. And this decline is more in rural areas as compared to the urban ones. But still, the child sex ratio in urban areas is less than that of the rural areas. These differences induce us to look at the trends in sex ratio at birth, because this sex ratio today would be having its impact on child sex ratio in next 6 years and also upon overall sex ratio thereafter. In India, we have observed that the overall sex ratio has increased, but there is a decline in child sex ratio. The child sex ratio depends upon two factors: the sex ratio at birth and the infant mortality rate. But during the last 6 years, we have registered an increase in sex ratio at birth in both the rural and urban areas, which means that the number of girls taking birth per 1,000 of boys has been increasing. But still, we are having a decline in child sex ratio, which indicates a greater mortality rate in the age group 0 to 6 years for girls. Mortality among males and females. Although biologically the mortality rate in females of all age groups are considered to be less than the males if brought up in an equal environment, yet in a discriminating economy where the gender differences prevail in all other types of social discrimination, it is but natural that the female child would be less taken care of in terms of its nutritional and other health requirements. Therefore, they are more likely to succumb to minor curable ailments in their infancy or childhood. This leads to a greater mortality rate among females, which is the cause of decline in child sex ratio, even though there is an improvement in sex ratio at birth. This discriminatory attitude of the society leads to higher infant mortality and under 5 mortality rates for females as compared to males. We can observe from figure 10 that although the infant mortality rate has come down from 80 per 1000 in 1990 to 50 per 1000 in 2009, but the gender gap in infant mortality rates has remained the same during these 20 years. In 2009, the number of infant deaths was 49 per 1000 for males and 52 for the females. This difference is actually much higher if we look at it in terms of natural probability of child survival among the males and females. Further, figure 11 shows the under 5 mortality rates between 1990 and 2009. We can see that these rates have declined considerably from 118 in 1990 to 64 in 2009. But still, these rates are higher for females than males. However, one positive development is that in case of under 5 mortality rates, the gender differences are also narrowing as the country is improving on this front. Thus, the gender differences explain the reason behind the declining child sex ratio, or say, the missing girl children. Globally, over the past 50 years, have seen a dramatic decline in mortality in children, but still millions of children die prematurely and the childhood continues to be a time of vulnerability to a range of health risks, which are greater in degree among the girl children due to several cultural and social factors. Globally, the leading causes of death and disability in girls under 10 years of age are communicable diseases, that is, respiratory tract infections and diarrhea, and neonatal conditions, that is, low birth weight, birth, asphyxia, and trauma, which together account for over 60% of the total, which is about 65% for the low-income countries. In high-income countries, greater proportion of these deaths take place due to congenital anomalies, prematurity, low birth rates, and neonatal infections, while deaths due to other diseases such as diarrhea, low respiratory infections, etc. are very low, which are the main feature of low-income countries. Most deaths in children under the age of 10 take place before they reach their fifth birthday. Despite considerable improvements in child survival over the past two decades, every year some 4.3 million girl children under 5 years die from conditions that are largely preventable and treatable. The main causes of these deaths are prematurity and low birth weight, neonatal infections, diarrheal diseases, and post-neonatal acute respiratory infections, mainly pneumonia. It is estimated that 200 million girl children under 5 years of age fail to reach their full potential because of poor health, which is a direct cause of malnutrition. In addition to malnutrition, or say undernutrition, other leading risk factors for girl child mortality and ill health include unsafe water, poor sanitation and hygiene, suboptimal breastfeeding, and indoor smoke from solid fuels. The World Health Organization in 2009 estimated that a very large proportion of girl child deaths take place very early in life, usually within the first month. Deaths in this neonatal period represent nearly half of girl child deaths in all regions. As overall levels of child mortality decline, the proportion of total deaths during the neonatal period tends to increase. To a significant extent, this is because critical interventions during this period depend on a well-functioning health system that is able to deliver high-quality care to pregnant women and their newborn infants. But access to such care is unattainable in many settings, particularly for the urban poor households whose children are more likely to die than those living in richer ones. Let us come to the conclusion of this lecture. We have observed that although urban areas have better health facilities than the rural areas, but the urban poor and within the poor segments of the society, the women do not have better health outcomes. They suffer from malnutrition, and so greater number of them is underweight and suffers from severe anemia. It has also been found that the incidence of diseases like tuberculosis, diabetes, thyroid disorders, asthma, etc. is more in case of women vis-a-vis men. We have also found lower sex ratio at birth in the age group 0 to 6 years and also among the adults in urban areas. While the sex ratio in urban India has increased during the last decade, but the child sex ratio has declined. This is due to the fact that the infant mortality as well as the under 5 mortality rates are higher for females than males. WHO has estimated that a major proportion of these deaths are preventable, and the minor problems among the females prove to be fatal only due to lack of adequate health facilities and proper care. Therefore, there should be adequate emphasis on improving the health facilities, both in terms of quantity and quality. These health facilities should not only be accessible to general masses, but also be affordable for the urban poor. Health systems reflect the societies that create them. An equitable health system should be responsive to the needs of the majority of the population, and they must not be perpetuating health inequalities. Since the women are the main users of the health system, the latter must become more responsive to the needs and expectations of women. Improving women's health not only matters to them alone, but also to their families, communities, and societies at large. As WHO states, that improving women's health means improving the world. That's all with today's lecture. I hope you must have enjoyed this lecture. Next time we'll meet another topic. Till then, have a nice time. Thank you.